Oggi la situazione dei mercati obbligazionari europei sta rapidamente cambiando. Vediamo come. A fronte di una crescita dell'economia, i rendimenti dei titoli di Stato mostrano una notevole compressione. Una delle cause può essere imputata a un eccessivo volume di acquisti da parte della BCE e dai tassi di interesse bloccati a zero nel tempo. Il volume degli acquisti dei bond europei è stato superiore alle nuove emissioni. La conseguenza è la riduzione dei rendimenti. Questa situazione si ripercuote anche sui corporate bond, che specialmente nel 2016 sono stati caratterizzati da rendimenti in costante discesa. La compressione dello spread penalizza in particolare i corporate bond dell'area euro, una criticità che influisce sensibilmente anche sui rendimenti. In altre parole, a fronte di spread e rendimenti ai minimi, i prezzi dei titoli non rispecchiano più in modo corretto il rischio implicito nelle emissioni, che sembra svanito a fronte di rendimenti quasi nulli e prezzi di mercato alle stelle. In Italia notiamo una preoccupante anomalia che si evidenzia in misura maggiore rispetto ad altri paesi, come la Francia e la Spagna. La barra blu indica lo stock delle obbligazioni corporate con rendimento maggiore ai corrispettivi titoli di Stato, mentre la barra rossa rappresenta la porzione dei corporate dove il rendimento è più basso rispetto al corrispondente governativo. La differenza della realtà italiana è sotto gli occhi di tutti. Il rischio viene poi ulteriormente aumentato dal trend rialzista dell'inflazione in Europa. Un vero campanello di allarme per chi detiene obbligazioni e per un eventuale cambio di rotta da parte della BCE. Di norma c'è sempre stata una relazione diretta tra inflazione core e il rendimento dei bond. Dopo il 2016 si è verificata una netta inversione di tendenza della linea inflativa, mentre il titolo tedesco è tuttora al di sotto della stessa. Ciò che sembra è un ritorno alla normalità, che rischia però di avere un impatto negativo su chi è esposto significativamente su tali bond. La situazione è dunque al limite e prospetta il rischio di uno scenario simile a quello degli Stati Uniti del 2013. Anche un semplice errore di comunicazione della BCE potrebbe indurre i mercati a una reazione scomposta, che andrebbe a penalizzare sensibilmente le quotazioni dei titoli in circolazione, anche in modo brusco e repentino. In questo contesto, quindi, i rischi per gli investitori sono ben maggiori di quanto percepito. Come mettersi al riparo?
Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti, grazie per essere venuti. Io mi presento, sono Matteo Lenardon, Deputy Country Head di Legg Mason e sono felice di introdurvi la nostra conferenza, che è un invito. Un invito è uno stimolo a iniziare un dibattito su un tema che crediamo nei prossimi mesi debba e ovviamente possa essere interessante, ma soprattutto fondamentale da tenere sott'occhio. Think Global, obbligazioni europee al capolinea? Ecco, l'abbiamo visto chiaramente dal video. Il contesto lo conosciamo bene. La BCE ha acquistato 2.200, oltre 2.200 miliardi di euro di obbligazioni europee, governative e societarie, con un programma di acquisto che è partito a 60 miliardi ogni mese per essere aumentata a 80 miliardi al mese, per poi chiaramente nel corso dei mesi essere ridotto, e da gennaio di quest'anno sono 30 miliardi ogni mese con un termine a settembre di quest'anno. Questo ha rappresentato oltre un triennio di ottime performance, lo avete visto tutti nei vostri portafogli, i vostri clienti hanno goduto di performance fenomenale. Perché? Perché il rendimento, grazie a questo rastrellamento enorme sul mercato, il rendimento di quelle obbligazioni è sceso e si è compresso significativamente. Adesso, un'altra cosa che conosciamo bene è che gli investitori europei, sia retail sia istituzionali, compresi i risparmiatori italiani, sono molto esposti alle obbligazioni domestiche. Allora, noi crediamo sia arrivato il momento e vogliamo iniziare a domandarci. È ancora l'obbligazionario europeo un asset class che possiamo considerare caratterizzata da bassa volatilità? Per parlare di questo voglio introdurvi il mio ospite, Amanda Stitt, Investment Director e Head of Fixed Income Product Specialist di Legg Mason. Buongiorno Amanda.
Good morning.
Allora, Amanda, vorrei iniziare con questa molto semplice domanda. Il QE, quindi il quantitative easing, il programma di acquisto della BCE, pare verosimile si concluda. E è inevitabile, sarà inevitabile la normalizzazione della politica monetaria della BCE. Quali saranno le insidie, quali insidie vogliamo segnalare e direi quali elementi i nostri gestori obbligazionari, ricordo che Legg Mason ha oltre 400 miliardi in attivi gestiti attivamente in obbligazionari globali, ecco quali sono gli elementi che i nostri gestori obbligazionari stanno monitorando e tenendo sotto osservazione in questo momento.
Okay, I don't know what you said because I don't speak Italian. But in relation to how we view people who are treating their risk-off assets here in Italy. In Italy, it seems that a lot of people actually hold their risk-off assets in things like corporate bonds and very domestic government bonds, BTPs. Now, in our mind, that is actually skewing your portfolio to a part of the market which we think is potentially very, very bubbly. Now, if we actually use the word bubble in any context at the moment, it would be to German government bonds. There is no justification for a Bund to be trading at 50 basis points when you look at it from a fundamental perspective. The entire market is priced based off technicals, nothing fundamental. Now, as Matteo probably said in his introduction, the allocation to BTPs, government bonds, and credit over the last 3 years would have worked very, very well for you. The question is, going forward, is that the type of risk-off or low-volatility product you want to have or portfolio you want to have, priced purely off technicals? And I think this graph actually says a lot. Almost half of the Italian corporate bond market is priced below government bonds. Now, there are some legitimate reasons why that can happen. There are very high-quality companies in Italy, some of which, from a credit quality perspective, are actually higher quality than Italian government bonds. But it does scream abnormality. And when there's abnormality in the market, it tends to correct. Now, no one knows exactly when it will correct, but I think fundamentals always rule in the end. Now, the question is, how is this going to play out? What's the next step for the ECB? And I don't think anyone would argue that Mario Draghi has done a bad job. In fact, I think he's done a very, very good job. Interestingly, some time ago, I had the pleasure of sitting next to Lord Merv King, the ex-head of the Bank of England. I asked him the question, if you were head of the European Central Bank, what would you do? And he said, I wouldn't have taken the job. It's a very difficult job. Now, he spent a lot of effort, Mario Draghi, getting quantitative easing happening. A lot of effort. For him to unwind that, he wants to be exceptionally sure that it is the right time, that Europe has in fact healed. Now that is a good thing, we want that, because of course if he actually takes it off, big chance he won't be able to put quantitative easing back on. But then it suggests that potentially he will be late to the story. Now if you're late to the story, that could potentially mean that you're going to get inflation concerns. And if the market prices in inflation aggressively here in Europe, you could see a response in German bonds, you'll see a response in BTPs, Italian government bonds, and of course, you'll see a response in corporate bonds as well, particularly given they're being priced under government bonds. Another thing that hasn't been priced into the market is, of course, the fiscal stimulus that potentially is coming here in Europe as well. Now we know in Italy, no matter who or what the government looks like going forward, all want to introduce further fiscal stimulus. In Germany, they are actually trying to increase fiscal stimulus at the equivalent of 1.25% of GDP. Now that puts the stability pact out the window. And that means there has to be an ECB response. And if that ECB response gets priced quickly into the market, what you considered as your risk-off markets aren't going to be risk-off. Those low-volatile markets aren't going to be low volatility. They'll be priced aggressively. And that's what we think people should be aware of when they're looking at their portfolios.
Thank you, Amanda. Allora, la seconda domanda viene spontanea e siamo nell'ambito delle congetture. Dunque, dobbiamo iniziare a tracciare degli scenari, il cosiddetto what's next. In altri termini, cosa può accadere? E sappiamo che lo status quo deve cambiare, ma cosa può accadere?
It's a really hard question and it's a very important question. But the problem is there is no precedence for what happens when this kind of unwind happens. Of course, you have the US already having to start their unwind program, but they have an advantage. They were the first. And they also started when yields were a lot higher. So when Japan unwinds and when the ECB unwinds, it's going to be a very different picture because the supply and demand is very, very different. Now, the one thing that we have that you can use as potentially an example is taper tantrum. And we all know what taper tantrum was like back in 2013. Just remember when Bernanke only suggested to the market that he would increase interest rates 6 months after quantitative tapering. You saw what happened. And this is, again, this is government bonds, US Treasuries, and investment grade. In the space of 2 months, you lost 5%. Now, that's not meant to happen in your low volatility portfolio. And of course, this was, as I said, in a different environment. This was when yields were a lot higher. And when you have yields a lot higher, that's your buffer. So if interest rates are going up and you've got a higher yield, that income offsets it.
Amanda, you call it cushion. In inglese viene definito il cuscino.
Exactly, everyone wants a cushion. And unfortunately here in Europe, there is no cushion. And in fact, as you saw in corporate bonds, trading under government bonds, that's no cushion at all. So even though taper tantrum is potentially the best example we have of how this could play out, I think it could be understating the severity of it could happen, of what could happen. So we just need to be aware of what is potentially going to occur maybe over the next year, maybe over the next 3 years. No one knows when the market's going to price it in, but it's almost inevitable that it will be priced in at some point.
Thank you. Qui in realtà diciamo è inevitabile, però c'è una disconnessione. There's an anomaly, right? If you want to put your translation up. L'anomalia in questo caso, secondo noi, secondo i nostri gestori, diciamo che è il mercato in questo momento presta in realtà una normalizzazione perfetta, senza alcun tipo di sussulto. Ma dobbiamo davvero crederci?
Well, this is it. You've got two extremes. So let's just say we have a situation of which growth is stronger than what we're expecting. That's going to be damaging because, of course, we have to normalize quicker. We have to raise interest rates quicker. So that's going to be a problem for your risk-off assets. Then, of course, if growth is a lot slower and inflation doesn't take off at all, and we all know that there's this secular versus cyclical theme at the moment on inflation, but if that is, in fact, growth negative, that's not going to work either because you're invested in corporate bonds that rely on good growth. So the market now is positioned for exactly in between those two scenarios. If it deviates in any way on either side, it's going to be problematic. So normalization, the actual perfect pricing of a perfect normalization process, which we're experiencing now, is not really realistic, because if you think of any central bank activity, particularly ones of this magnitude, do they ever not make one single mistake? Do they never say one word when they're actually communicating to the market that leads the market to think one way or the other? So it's a very, very difficult job. And of course, Draghi is probably the master of communication. Mm-hmm. We know that. He's going next year. Who is going to be the master going forward?
Draghi, sappiamo, l'anno prossimo uscirà di scena. Abbiamo già qualche segnale di chi potrebbe essere il suo successore, di cosa possiamo aspettarci?
Yeah, there are suggestions who is going to replace Draghi going forward, and we all know who they are, particularly if it is the German, which will be interesting because it's not just Draghi who's leaving. It's in fact, depending on how you look at the ECB, whether it's the voting board, et cetera, or the rotation board, it's between two-thirds or one-third of the board that's changing over the next 2 years. So yes, the chairman or the head of the ECB is exceptionally important, but the whole board is important. Now, just keep in mind that, not suggesting that this was the case, but if it tilts towards a German leading, does that mean it's going to tilt towards more monetary policy led by German fundamentals? Now, if that is the case, Germany is doing very, very well. There is absolutely no excess capacity in that market. They're doing exceptionally well. In fact, it's a massive abnormality on its growth path, its financial conditions, all of that versus interest rates at the moment. That is the big anomaly. So if we actually tilt monetary policy towards more that than peripheral, that's going to be different.
Ecco, cosa vogliamo iniziare a suggerire ai nostri interlocutori per prepararsi? C'è ancora tempo per iniziare a prepararsi a queste insidie.
I think the objective of my speech interview this morning isn't to scare you. So I'm not here saying that things are going to go horribly wrong. They might go perfectly well. You might have a situation like you've had over the last 3 years. The normalization process could be very, very easy. But is it right to have everything that you have for low volatility diversification in your portfolio positioned in this market, dependent on one variable, the removal of the biggest buyer in history in Europe? So our proposition was, you need to diversify. You need to look globally where the opportunities are. And we actually think there's quite a few opportunities outside of Europe. One thing you do have to do, though, and this is very important, actually look at your portfolios. Actually look not only at your own asset allocation, but look at the managers that you have and just check whether they have a structural bias to Europe. Basically meaning they'll always invest in Europe, regardless of what the potential pitfalls may be going forward. So really look for a global manager that doesn't have that structural bias. And I think once you do that, you can actually start to see some of these global opportunities that we have in the market. From our perspective, one of the biggest opportunities we see is in emerging markets. The others I'll talk about in a second, but emerging markets is a very fascinating one. When you think of fundamentals, I've talked about European fundamentals completely not being captured in yields. The fundamentals in emerging markets are just as healthy as Europe, but the pricing is so much better. There is no technical influence in emerging markets. Now, where we are in the cycle, growth is improving, trade dynamics are great. Where emerging markets are benefiting is the inflation story. They've come from a period of very, very high inflation. They had to raise rates to defend the currency. This is at the back end of the commodity cycle. And at the back end of the commodity cycle. And for that reason, they actually had a period of which they were cutting interest rates. Now, this period of cutting interest rates obviously was very beneficial for clients who were investing in it. But what I find fascinating at the moment is from a real yield perspective, so after adjusting for inflation, emerging markets are just as cheap as they were 3 years ago. So we've had a great rally. We've had a great rally in emerging markets. Now, I think probably the biggest question that we've had over the course of the last year or so is the rally over? I would suggest we're actually only halfway through it. Now, the reason why I say we're only halfway through it is if you look at the performance of emerging markets since the financial crisis versus treasuries versus high yield, and this is local emerging markets, you've only just outperformed treasuries. You've only performed a third of the performance that high yield has had. So from a valuation perspective, it looks really good. From a fundamental perspective, it looks really good. And from a technical perspective, you don't have this abnormality. So for us, an emerging market investment, obviously not everything, We want to diversify here, but there are countries that really offer good value. And I think another important slide here is the bottom one, where you can see the currency. Now, again, we've seen currencies in emerging markets do very, very well. And of course, currencies are more volatile than other things. So again, diversification is key. But even after we've had this big currency rally, look how cheap it is versus where it has been. It hasn't really moved when you put it into the perspective of what we saw over that 3-year drawdown. So for us, emerging markets is a great opportunity. Another one that we think is a good opportunity, but again, when I say good opportunity, there is nothing in credit globally that is cheap as a sector.
Maybe you can come back. Yeah. Maybe you can come back.
So there's nothing globally that looks cheap in credit at the moment. So I suggest that not investing in European credit is a good idea, but also you have to start looking at the US credit market. Now again, as I said, not cheap, but this is the biggest credit market in the world. There are 6 times the size of the European credit market. Now there has to be opportunities there, and we do think there's opportunities there. Very specific companies, a lot of upgrades, so you have to look at credit from a long, short perspective. Don't ignore the rest of the world because there is other opportunities rather than just in Europe. So that's an important one. High yield, IG, investment grade, emerging markets, global opportunities. The other important thing is the last point, long, short. And when we're talking about long, short, we're talking about long, short, mainly interest rates. You don't want to be in a portfolio that is solely dependent on interest rates either being stable or not going up dramatically. You don't want complete blindness or complete correlation, if you like, to interest rates going up. What you do want is to have a position of which you can make money when interest rates go up. And you have to do that through, obviously, a manager that can take short positions. Now, we have as a way of example one of the portfolios within Legg Mason, which is a total return global portfolio that can take long and short positions. And here you can see over the period, this is year to date. Year to date, that blue section, you can see we have short positions on a lot of core markets at the moment because we think developed market interest rates are expensive. So we've actually taken a short position there, and you can see how much that's generated over the year to date. So having that ability to recognize when interest rates are expensive and when interest rates are cheap is an important attribute to a portfolio manager. And of course, we like to think that we can add value. That's it.
Chiaramente solo una gestione attiva, un gestore attivo con un'esperienza, direi pluriennale, è in grado di ricavare il cosiddetto alfa, in grado di ricavare una performance che esula dalla performance degli indici andando short sulle curve. Sappiamo che le curve, diciamo, possono muoversi in alto e in basso, chiaramente la magnitudo rappresenta la volatilità, ma riuscire a trovare il momento giusto per andare corti su una curva, ecco, in questo caso abbiamo la prova fattuale che è opportuno e che protegge, ovviamente andando a contribuire alla performance di un prodotto. Qui davanti abbiamo un prodotto vero, un prodotto effettivo gestito da uno dei gestori di Legg Mason. Ecco.
There's one thing I didn't mention. Perfetto. Looking at this graph as well as the diversification factor. Diversifying your sources of alpha. And this is a way that you can generate lower volatility returns that is uncorrelated to the direction of interest rates in Europe, which is obviously, in our minds, one of the biggest concerns.
Un recap, ovviamente questo è il nostro giveaway, è il nostro gadget, diciamo. Vogliamo lasciarvi con quello che è il consiglio. Il nostro suggerimento è dunque, innanzitutto, tornare alla diversificazione. Ci siamo un po' abituati bene, diciamo. Nell'ultimo triennio l'obbligazionario domestico ha, per l'ennesima volta direi, dal 2011 ad oggi, pagato. Consigliamo ancora di valutare bene tutti i vostri portafogli, verificare ciascun gestore cosa ha all'interno di ciascun prodotto, porre un pochino di attenzione in più a quelli che sono i sovrappesi strutturali che non cambieranno mai, i cosiddetti prodotti pan-European, ad esempio. Stiamo attenti a che cosa può essere il riposizionamento, come ha segnalato Amanda, delle curve dei governativi e chiaramente il gap ancora più profondo che dovrà riempirsi sui societari. Ecco, con questo io vorrei lasciare la possibilità di fare un paio di domande al pubblico. Se ce n'è qualcuna qui in sala, abbiamo già ricevuto alcune domande anche dagli iscritti tramite email. Lascio la parola a voi se qualcuno di voi avesse qualche domanda.
Buongiorno, volevo chiedere alla signora alcune previsioni sul cambio, se investire coperti o meno sul dollaro, sui paesi emergenti oppure su obbligazioni americane. Un suo parere.
Yeah, from a currency perspective, in our minds, one of the most expensive currencies in the world is the US dollar. So when we're talking about investing in local emerging markets, we suggest local currency. So whether it be the Mexican peso, whether it be the Indonesian rupiah, all of those offer a better opportunity than investing in emerging market US dollars. Now, the advantage also of buying local emerging markets is the interest rates. That's one of the big attractions that you have, and that's one of the slides that we showed, is if you buy local emerging markets, your interest rate differential is at least 3-4% different from the US. Obviously in Europe, even more so. So that obviously is a cushion, again, through this volatile period, that you can still earn a yield, even if we have a little bit of volatility going forward. So the US dollar, we think, as I said, one of the most expensive currencies, when you look at it from a valuation perspective. Europe is pretty well priced at the moment, to be honest, the euro versus the US dollar. Clearly last year was a brilliant year for the euro, probably forecasting less of that going forward. And we don't really have a big position either way in Europe. We do actually prefer in Europe some of the peripheral European currencies over the euro. And the reason why we prefer that is because peripheral countries like the Nordics particularly, they have a very different monetary policy. They have a lot more flexibility in their monetary policy, and they have higher yields in some cases as well. So for that reason, when we're taking European positions, we're not taking them in euros, we're taking them in Norwegian krone, Swedish krona, even the Polish zloty, which has done very, very well, particularly last year.
Altra domanda per caso? Ok, io faccio una... Ah, prego. Attendo un attimo, arriva il gelato, così sentono tutti e anche Amanda in cuffia.
È collegata alla domanda precedente perché oltre che ovviamente il rischio cambio per quanto riguarda diciamo, l'investimento su obbligazioni corporate US piuttosto che su emerging market c'è anche diciamo, un rischio legato anche alla duration perché rispetto per esempio alle obbligazioni investment grade europee comunque già andare ad investire globalmente su obbligazioni corporate globali piuttosto che sulla parte US o investire sulla parte di mercati emergenti comunque ci portiamo diciamo anche un rischio di duration e quindi bisogna anche valutare quel cuscinetto di cui parliamo quanto poi possa essere sufficiente a, in una fase magari di rialzo dei tassi statunitensi.
Immagino che, e mi permetto di reinterpretare, qui si inneschi la view dei gestori di Legg Mason su cosa può accadere ancora nel processo di rialzo dei tassi al di fuori dell'area Europa?
What's interesting about US corporate bonds at the moment, and certainly the US Treasury curve, is the market has already priced in a normalization path. The market, particularly in February, the market priced in above what the Fed was expecting to do over the course of the next 18 months. They're now pricing in interest rates higher than what the Fed has suggested they'll go to as a terminal rate. So what that effectively means, very different to Europe. Europe, still, there's very little pricing in of any monetary policy change going forward for the next 2 years. The US have already made that interest rate adjustment. And for that reason, you're going to have far less interest rate risk on that. Now, where you have the risk is if the market's wrong. If, in fact, inflation in the US is higher than the market has now priced in, and of course, if that is the case, monetary policy has to adjust up and you'll clearly have duration risk then. Our view is the market's pricing it pretty well at the moment. Potentially, they were underpricing inflation at the beginning of the year. Now it's priced pretty effectively. And that's a very different scenario to Europe. This is why we think there's so much duration risk in Europe versus the US. And similarly, in emerging markets, some emerging markets are still cutting rates, and that's a good thing from a capital gains perspective. So having duration in some of these emerging markets, not only are you getting the yield, but you could potentially get the capital gain as the market, as capital gains come through as they're cutting monetary policy, which hasn't yet been priced into it.
Bene. Se non vi è altra domanda, io andrei a concludere. Vi ringrazio molto e per questa, io spero che questo tipo di conferenza sia stata per voi uno stimolo. Grazie per la partecipazione. Vi ricordo che Legg Mason offre una serie di soluzioni che abbiamo tra l'altro in focus su base obbligazionaria globale. Ecco perché l'invito, ritorno a ricordarlo, Think Global, su base globale e soprattutto attiva, noi crediamo di poter riuscire a rappresentare una valida soluzione per prepararsi a quelli che possono essere, come segnalava Amanda, i rischi dovuti alla normalizzazione della politica monetaria, i rischi, diciamo, intrinseci e asimmetrici di quello che è avere duration, ad esempio, europea, in questo momento in portafoglio. Noi abbiamo alcune soluzioni, di cui queste tre saremo felici di approfondire con voi al nostro stand qui al Salone del Risparmio. È stato per me un piacere, in una kermesse così importante per il risparmio gestito, offrirvi questo momento di approfondimento. Grazie ancora e rimaniamo a disposizione.